Not our first time doing Airbnb, but my first time in Las Vegas doing an Airbnb.
Okay. Well, how was Vegas?
The whole trip was great.
Yeah.
We went down for a wedding, so and we did all our bachelor and bachelorette parties down there at the same time. The whole trip was great until our very last night, and things went awry from there. Our last night, we decided we'd get dressed up, and all of us went out to Fremont Street, and we went out for a bite to eat and to see the sights and watch a concert, do all that kind of stuff. We left at about 10:30 that night, 9:30, 10:30, somewhere around there anyways.
What kind of place is it? Is it like an apartment or a house or...
Yeah, we had rented a house. There was six of us, that like three couples, that had rented a house through Airbnb, just so that we could all stay together. You know, we thought it would be something that would be fun, a little more inclusive than staying in a hotel. And, you know, we can chill if we need to or go out and do something if we need to. It was only about a $10 Uber ride to the Strip, so we weren't very far from the Strip, so we thought it was, like, the best of both worlds. The last night, like I said, we went down to Fremont Street, all six of us, and then the bride and groom.
Okay.
We met down there, and at about 2 in the morning, we thought we would beat the rush of getting a cab after the little street concert they had. We thought we'd beat the rush, and we got an Uber. Got back to our house.
And 2 in the morning is very responsible for Las Vegas. I mean, that's an early night, eh?
I know. I know. Don't judge us. Yeah, so, you know, it was our last night there, and, you know, we all had, one couple had a flight earlier in the morning. We weren't flying out, us and another couple weren't flying out until the evening, but, you know, thought we'd get back and get some sleep and pack up and do all that fun adulting stuff.
Yep.
We got back at about 2 in the morning, and I should say that there was, we were assured, you know, there's security cameras, the door has a keypad, like there's lots of security features in this house that we were assured about. And, you know, it was posted as a family-friendly site and a good area to stay in. So, you know, like, we did our research on our house. It's not like we just picked the first one and went with it. But we got back. I was the first one in the door. And I noticed that all the cushions on the couch were off. And I was like, who the hell left the house like that? Like, who was the last person out the door? And then it dawned on me, none of us left it like that because we all left together. And then as we were kind of, in hindsight, crazy, but we all went through the house and we're looking at the house and realized that every single item that we brought with us to Las Vegas was gone. I'm talking dirty underwear. I'm talking toothbrushes. They took the groceries that we had out of the fridge. They took our butter, like frozen burger patties and hash browns and bacon, like literally everything. They took phone chargers and headphones and the prescription glasses, my husband's wedding band, our suitcases. They packed our suitcases with our stuff and took it out the door. Like they took, there's three girls that were in there and we all, you know, had flat irons and curling irons and hair dryers all plugged in, and they took the time to unplug those and pack them, and out the door they went.
Huh. Wow.
Yeah.
So,
and then as things were unfolding and as we were thinking, you know, going through things, we realized that when we're looking around and not one single thing that belonged to the Airbnb was stolen. So there was a 60-inch flat-screen TV still on the wall. There was things like there was a Vitamix blender, like a microwave, like things that are hot items that are easy to hawk. None of that stuff was stolen. And they went through one of the girls' beds. She had like a fuzzy travel blanket. They went through the bed on her in her bed and took that travel blanket, but didn't touch anything of the Airbnb's blankets, any of their bedding.
Hmm.
Or like The only thing that was broken of the Airbnb, other than that one window, so who knows if it was broken before, but the only thing that was broken of theirs was like a locked, it was locked, a pantry that had like towels and cleaning supplies, but it was broken when we first got there. And I have a picture of that linen closet, and not a single thing was rustled in that linen closet. All the towels were still folded, the cleaning supplies were all still there. So, like, why steal butter and not towels and cleaning supplies?
Yeah, that's very odd.
Like a half a jug of milk.
So when you say the window was broken, was like the glass actually smashed, or was it just a lock that wasn't working?
No, it was just a lock.
Uh-huh.
So they had taken a chair around the side of the house, so away from the street.
Uh-huh.
They had, on the other side, they had taken a chair and crawled in through the master bathroom window, and then the master bedroom where we were, my husband and I, had a balcony door, and they just undid all the security features for, like, they had like a bar across and all locks and whatever, and that's the door that they took our stuff out of.
So then you said that they had told you that there was a bunch of cameras and that sort of thing. Have you guys been able to see any of this footage, or did they look it up?
So we've been told that there is a, the people that we contacted after we contacted state police, they're actually a managing company. So they manage this supposed homeowner's houses.
Mm.
And they sent us right away, they sent us security footage. But the thing that alarms us the most about that is that, A, they knew how to, like, I know that criminals think different than we do, but they knew. All they did to disable the security footage was they unplugged the modem. They didn't destroy anything. They didn't cover it up.
Yeah.
They just unplugged the modem. So for 2.5 hours, because we got timestamp footage of when they got to the house, and then from the time that we got to the house, so for 2.5 hours, that security footage was off. And we were told, as house rules, that if there was any evidence that those cameras were off or tampered with, that we'd be evicted immediately. So those cameras were off for 2.5 hours. Why were we not notified that, hey, there's something wrong with the security footage, either kicking us out or alerting us not to go back to the house, because we could have walked in on it. On them still robbing the place, and who knows if we didn't scare them off at that point.
Yeah, you'd think that if they said these cameras are going to be fully active, never disable them, or under threat of you have to leave right away, that there might be somebody monitoring those cameras or looking into what's going on and trying to help out. Wow. So,
exactly.
I mean, I guess basically from what you're describing, it kind of sounds like there's a little bit of a suggestion of, this seems more organized than just a break and enter where they just steal some stuff.
Exactly. And, you know, even if you're desperate for food or desperate for money for drugs, the things that they stole don't make sense.
Yeah. That does seem really odd that you would steal little bits of food. I mean, that's not something that's easily resellable, really. It's very confusing.
Like, I understand if you're hungry,
then
steal whatever you need to steal, or, you know, even if you are on drugs, steal what you gotta steal.
Yeah.
Things can be replaced, but it's just very weird things, like, why steal toothbrushes?
Yeah.
And, like, why not steal a microwave that's easy to lift, and a 60-inch screen TV is not that big, it's not that much bigger than our suitcases.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. If you're gonna take a suitcase full of blankets and clothes, you'd be better off leaving with the television. I don't know.
Exactly.
So was that, describe the area. Is this a busy area where there's lots of traffic outside, or?
There was traffic on, like, the main street. It was a quieter neighborhood. And actually, like, of course, things start flowing back in your memory.
Mm-hmm.
That night when we left, there was very little traffic on our actual street. Our house was on a corner. So there was like a main road that did have traffic going by, which is why they chose the other side of the house to break into, supposedly, chose that side. But that night when we were leaving, I made a comment that there was four vehicles that drove by really slowly around our Uber and around our house. And I had made a comment that night, like, holy Las Vegas traffic jam.
Yeah.
But I bet you any money we were being cased at that point, if not for the whole week.
Do you think that it's possible that criminals know which of these houses are Airbnb houses and target them because it's a lot harder to... I mean, now you're back in another country, right? So it's going to be a lot harder to actually solve the crime kind of thing.
Definitely. Like, in hindsight now, when I think about it, how much public information there is out there. So every address for an Airbnb is posted on the website.
Yeah.
Every time that it's occupied, it's also posted on the website because you're no longer able to book those days, right?
Oh, that's very true. Yeah, it's like knowing which room you're at in a hotel, pretty much.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So they do know, and they could probably see we were there for 6 days. They chose to break in and steal our stuff on the sixth day, or like the night of the, you know, on this last night that we were there. So typically speaking, most people's shopping is all done by then.
Yeah.
Because we were leaving on the Sunday.
That's the date when you would have possibly, if you won something at a casino, you might have the prize there, or if you were out shopping,
exactly.
You have all the new Nike sneakers or whatever it may be. Yeah, that would be the jackpot night.
Exactly. So lots of sketchy things. We did call state police.
Yeah.
In the United States, the rules that allow them to collect evidence, they have to have homeowners' permission in order to gain any evidence. The homeowners refused to answer the phones for the state police, so that blocked them from collecting as much evidence as possible.
Well, that's pretty strange. I mean, you'd think if you run an Airbnb that, you know, you'd be on the up and up. You'd be concerned about your home and the people that are renting, and you'd want to...
Yep.
Involve the police as quickly as possible.
Yep. That's but they weren't out anything, and they already knew that for sure.
Yeah.
So our saving grace is that, so we had a few saving graces, is that this supposed rental company, like, I don't know, I'm just saying supposed because I don't trust anybody now.
What's the name of the company?
I don't know. We were just told once we contacted them after we called the police,
mm-hmm.
we were told that they weren't the actual homeowners, that it was just mm-hmm. a rental or a property manager,
yeah.
basically.
You know, I've heard of this happening ever since the Airbnb became a big thing in major city centers, that it sort of became a little bit of a way to skirt some of the rental laws and some of the... some of the legislation on how a hotel is supposed to run, because it's not a hotel, it's just somebody letting somebody crash at their pad, but then it kind of becomes
exactly.
a little gray when there's companies managing homes for people, so.
Exactly. So those people actually were the ones that gave us the security camera footage, and we have a clear picture of the guy's face who broke in the house. The only other saving grace that we had was the idiot cut himself at some point somewhere, and he bled in the house, and he came and got trauma supplies from their little first aid kit, and he thankfully bled on some of my husband's clothes. So we actually had like Las Vegas CSI at the house. It was like out of a movie. We had Las Vegas CSI at our house collecting evidence, because we were able to give permission to Las Vegas CSI to collect that DNA evidence of the blood, because he bled on our clothes.
Okay.
And the other thing is that he had the audacity to sit down and have a drink out of our bottle of pop that we had from Mix. He sat down in the living room and drank that pop. So because we own that pop bottle, they were able to get fingerprints and saliva DNA from it.
And did they match up fingerprints with a known person, or?
We haven't heard yet. In the States, if you commit a felony, they collect DNA evidence from anybody who commits a crime like that.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully these idiots have had some sort of a criminal record, that their DNA will be on file and they'll be able to match them up. But, you know, in the moment, you're not thinking the broader picture. And the more that we sit back and think about it, we realize that it's not just a random attack. It hasn't just been something random. The bigger picture is that it's a whole scenario that's happened that I feel like we've been catfished.
Yeah, it's almost like somebody using the Airbnb system to create a situation where it would be very easy to break into the Canadians that are, you know, in a foreign place like Las Vegas or wherever, and get the stuff.
Even looking at the profile picture that they put on Airbnb, the description is like that she's a mother of two children, married and a mother of two children, something, something. She's 27 years old, but you look at the picture and she might have been 27 about 20 years ago. But those are little things that we didn't even think of in the moment. You know, we stared at Airbnb trying to decide which one to go to.
Yeah. How would I find the Airbnb listing for this place? Is there can I Google it? Or?
Yeah, actually, they're one of the first ones that pop up. So if you go to Airbnb website and just type in Las Vegas, Nevada homes, they're one of the, like, I think they're third or fourth that keeps popping up, which is part of the reason why, you know, we found them.
Okay,
right?
And I see they each have names. What's the name that's on that one?
Just hold on. If we're friends on Facebook, I did repost the link.
Okay. Yeah,
with everything
that
was on there. I think it says something. It's a picture of the living room is what it is. And it says, amazing house 2 minutes from the strip. And it's hosted by Leo.
Yeah, I see it here. I got the link.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's a beautiful looking place.
It is. It was.
And then so this user profile that says Leo,
yes.
It kind of seems like what you're saying is that wasn't really part of the whole experience, having Leo show you through her family home and leave you there.
No. And they refused to answer any phone calls. They wouldn't answer phones for state police, even when we got a hold of, I think that the supposed this property manager got a hold of them, they said they weren't even coming until the next day, as if we were staying there the rest of the time that we were booked in for the Airbnb.
Do you plan on leaving a review on the page?
Oh, a review's already been made, but it has not yet been posted.
Uh-huh. I'm not sure how the review system works for Airbnb, so it looks like when I look at the page, it's, you know, surprisingly looks like a couple of good reviews from seemingly real-looking avatars of people. So it's always
right,
hard to tell,
exactly.
Though. Like, I know that, for instance, in the restaurant industry in the United States, all over the world, really, where there's very highly competitive, you know, like on the Strip in Las Vegas, I'm sure, people pay vloggers and bloggers and internet writers to go on there and, you know, here's $5 for every positive review that you put on this restaurant, you know,
exactly.
Give it 5 stars, say we have the best steak. So, you know, when I look at these, it seems like it's always possible that that's what's going on there too.
Yep. There have been a few, like I went through all 48 reviews that were on there, and there's only two that said that it was not the best neighborhood. And they only responded to one of them saying that it is a safe neighborhood.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean,
so,
if you went through, I mean, it looks like there's over 300 reviews here. So if you read through a bunch of them, then I'd consider that like due diligence type thing, you know? It's like, yeah, you found out from the people whether this is good or not.
But, yeah, and the bad reviews were way down at the bottom. They were from like 2016, 2017. I have screenshot them and stuff too, so I don't know. It's just, there's way too much coincidence to say that points in that direction.
Yeah. I mean, Airbnb as a company benefits from them having all of the good reviews up top and renting places more often because they make a cut.
Right.
Very interesting.
So initially, when we contacted Airbnb, of course, we had a hell of a time getting back into Canada because we no longer have passports.
Oh, right.
They stole all 6 of our passports and our IDs and everything. We all at least had our driver's license on us. So once we got to the airport, we were told, well, for starters, the Canadian Embassy does not monitor their phones on at night or the weekends.
Oh.
So that was a shock.
That is.
No,
I think we all expect that, like, in the movies, you can call the embassy whenever and there's going to be somebody there to save you, right?
Right. So the U.S. embassy does, and I did speak to the U.S. embassy, but their hands are tied. We need the Canadian embassy. There's nothing that they can do.
Yeah.
So that was a shock to start with because we were trying to figure out how the hell we're going to get home.
Yeah.
And then we went to the airport, and I talked to, got a hold of the duty supervisor at TSA, and then because it was a week, because I think we got like a back line or something to the Canadian consulate or the embassy, and I did eventually talk to them, both of them, so the U.S. and Canada, both gave us permission to board the plane and fly home without our passports. But they said it's an airline discretion.
Right, so then...
So when I brought this information forward to Swoop and WestJet, because four of us flew Swoop and two of us flew WestJet,
mm-hmm.
Both companies denied us boarding and said that there's no chance of a return for our money because it would be considered a failure to provide documentation. So I had also paid for like trip cancellation or interruption, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, the insurance.
So after much arguments, I said, fine, if you're not going to bend the rules on that, we have no choice but to fly. We have to fly domestic because you're allowed to use your driver's license for that.
Mm-hmm.
We had to fly domestic to domestic. So we flew from Las Vegas to San Francisco, San Francisco to Seattle, and then we had to rent a vehicle and drive over the border because you're still allowed to drive across the border with only driver's license.
Right, so it was just basically the airline companies making it a little bit tougher at that point. Well, a lot tougher at
100%.
That point.
Yeah.
And they got a little bit extra money out of you for buying those flights?
Exactly. So the other thing I asked them to do, I said, if you're not going to budge on that, you're not going to, apparently it's the Canadian government that changed those rules that if we don't physically have a passport, we're not allowed on.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not going to budge on that, can you change our flights from, instead of being Las Vegas to Edmonton, can you change our flights from Abbotsford to Edmonton? So at least we're not out that money and don't have to fork out more money for that.
Yeah.
Because I had paid for trip cancellation and interruption and all that. So they told me, they said, had I let them know 24 hours in advance, they may have been able to do something about it.
Like, so if you were able to predict the robbery, then...
Exactly.
That's so
exactly.
Silly. Wow.
So all in all, we're each couple is out an extra $2,000, if not more.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, we were up for almost 60 hours traveling, our mission was to get back to Canada.
Yeah.
And so we drove all night. We were already up all night and all day.
Yeah.
And then we flew and drove all night and then flew home the next day after that.
I cannot imagine how much I would want to be home if all the things that were home to me had vanished overnight. I mean, you must just feel totally naked, like.
100%. I had to borrow a shirt. Thankfully, they left me a pair of underwear, which was really courteous of them. They left for me and my husband. But I had to borrow a shirt and a sweater. We were flying from the States, where it's warm, to Canada, where it's cold. And we didn't have any winter gear. We came back in flip-flops and t-shirts.
Let me ask, like, let's take it back to when you first arrived. I've never done the Airbnb thing, but anytime I've, you know, crashed at somebody's place, there's usually, even if they're, you know, not going to be at the place, there's usually somebody to kind of show you around or, I guess, give you the key even. How did that all work? Like, who was there a person from this management company? Or?
No, there was no one there. What they do is I'm not sure if it was another girl that had like physically booked it. So
uh-huh.
I'm not sure if they emailed her or sent her a message or through Airbnb, but they, it was a keypad lock. So they sent us the door code to get in.
And then once you're in, are there keys or does everybody just remember the door code?
Everyone just got the door code.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, I think that's interesting that, like, you don't actually have an interaction with a person at any point. Because, I mean, at the very least, at a hotel, if you're checking out, they always say, you know, how was your stay? What happened? Is there anything we can do to improve? You know? So with the Airbnb thing, not having somebody there seems like a... It almost seems like it makes it easier for them to not be identified or not be known, you know?
Right. So typically, I think that Airbnb's rules are no physical interaction. They don't want you to contact each other outside of Airbnb for safety reasons. However, I asked them what their screening process is like for their hosts.
Mm-hmm.
Because as a person staying at an Airbnb, you have to be verified before they'll even allow you to make an account.
Yeah, yeah.
So you have to provide a picture, you have to provide government-issued photo ID, and you have to verify your address and all that kind of stuff. You have to be verified in order to stay at an Airbnb. And when I asked them the questions of what is the screening process to be a host, do you guys do a criminal record check? Do you guys do a background check? The conversation ended.
So basically all you have to do is have a building that people could sleep inside of, I guess.
Right.
And then you're on the list. Yeah, because it says here that also, I'm on their website right now, the Airbnb website says... that there's information that could be shared with the host, and that would be the first name on your ID, whether you're over 25 years old, whether your ID has been successfully added, and your profile photo and name. So when you make your profile on Airbnb, I'm guessing there's a good chance you just use the same Facebook profile picture?
I think something along those lines. I can't even remember what I used.
Because, I mean, it wouldn't necessarily be that difficult for the person that's hosting the place to get that information and then look up your Facebook and then sort of follow you along on your trip, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And other things that we didn't take into consideration for safety, because Canadians don't think like this, and it's a huge lesson to learn. But, you know, we got picked up and dropped off at the same spot all the time. So we got picked up from the house, got dropped off back at the house, mm-hmm. rather than picking, you know, a block down the road or a block back mm-hmm. and walking in. Another thing, they probably pegged us as high rollers. A, they knew that we were all paramedics. Well, two of the girls that were staying there are paramedics. So myself and the girl that booked it. So... they know that in Canada, the paramedics make good wages.
Mm-hmm.
They also knew that our spouses were in oil field, so we definitely got pegged that way. Another thing that we did, so all six of us split a limo ride, and we got, like, the craziest limo from the airport to the house. We had bachelor, bachelorette party, and wedding. So we had limo for all three of those events.
Mm-hmm.
So we were taking limos to and from. Plus they knew what our occupations were.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, sometimes when it comes to weddings, the gift is an envelope with a bunch of cash in it. And, you know, like it's like when you, the first thing you said was that they had pulled up all of the, pillow cushions on the couch and stuff like that. It almost seems like they had something in mind or they.
Right.
They knew what to look for. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So
it's been quite the experience.
Yeah. So I'm very glad that you were able to make it back to Canada without all the required paperwork for all that stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems
thankfully,
like
U.S. Customs, like at the border, they were amazing there. Like, it's probably the quickest I've ever been in and out of there in general. Like, we did have to get out of the vehicle and go in and go through, like, all their questions and whatnot. But it was such a quick process. And you know what both of them said right off the hop? You guys stayed at an Airbnb, didn't you? So,
like, they've seen it before kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Wow.
This is not the first time. And my goal is that we're fighting with everyone to get our money back. So Swoop told CTV News that they would be in contact with us. They have not.
Mm-hmm.
They said that they would work out an agreement with us. They have not contacted us, for starters. Airbnb said that had we contacted them before checkout, this was the initial conversation, had they contacted them before checkout, so like during the home invasion,
yeah.
because it was at the very end.
Right.
So had we contacted them, they might be able to do something. But unfortunately, because we waited until we got back to Canada to contact them, there's nothing that they can do.
Which only makes sense. I mean, you want to get yourself in a place where you're feeling safe before you start,
dealing with this stuff. I took the means to go public and go on social media.
Yeah.
And I have tagged everyone under the sun that I can think of. So last night on Twitter, their Airbnb security person contacted me through Twitter, and I've given them all they said they'd like more information. So I said things like, what would you like to know? Would you like to know that everything from my toothbrush to my underwear to my suitcases, purse, wallet, ID, passports got taken, and not a single thing of the Airbnb's, like linens or TV, microwave, Vitamix, those kind of things. Like, what do you want to know? That they refuse to cooperate with state police. They won't respond to any of our messages. We put in a request for a refund. That's what Airbnb had suggested to do, was put in a request for a refund. They denied that claim, but will not respond to us anyway. And they keep saying that their liability insurance is for the host. There's no liability that they owe to us. And that's when I started asking questions like, what is your screening process for these hosts? Because ultimately, we got their name through Airbnb. Had there not been Airbnb involved, we would never have found these people.
Yeah.
So there's got to be some liability. So now they're saying that they will, they've re-looked at the case now that I've gone social media. They've re-looked at the case, and they're considering allowing us to extend the host liability insurance claim. They're extending that to us, but nothing's been approved up until this point.
When it comes to Airbnb, have you ever been able to speak to anybody on the phone? I don't see any phone number anymore.
No. Nope. Number contacts.
That's got to be a little bit frustrating,
Swoop,
too.
Swoop was another one. If you want to talk to someone on the phone, you have to pay $15.
To talk to the airline?
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. Everything was done through social media. So even when we tried to contact Swoop to say exactly what we needed from them.
Yeah.
And then they're another company that just stopped conversation with us. They refused to respond. And I'm sure as hell not giving them another $15 of my money, whatever I have left, to talk to someone on the phone.
Yeah, I mean, before even making the call, it feels like there's a sense of disappointment thinking about calling a 1-800 number and paying them $15 to probably be told there's nothing we can do.
Exactly.
You know, because at that point I'd be like, well, I want my $15 back, and then there'd be a whole other argument to have, right?
Exactly.
Wow.
We weren't asking for money back at that point. We were just asking for a helping hand.
Yeah.
You can pull anything you want. TSA can pull whatever they want, whatever information they want on you. They can pull, you know, we're all gainfully employed people. None of us have a criminal record. You know, we had Las Vegas case file. We had police reports. You know, it's something that happened to us, not our own liability.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we got drunk in Vegas and lost all of our stuff.
Well, and considering the Canadian government and the U.S. government agreed that it was okay and you didn't need them, it seems strange that the, you know, that the airline company would somehow have a stricter approach to documents than the government would.
Right.
Really,
and
sucks.
Do you know how many times you scan your passport trying to get into the States?
Yeah.
It's insane. Now you scan everything. You scan. So it's not like they didn't have us on file. We were flying with the same company to and from. So don't give me we can't do anything attitude, because you know, and we always fly WestJet because we know they bend over backwards for their patrons, for their customers. They always do. They go above and beyond all the time, which is why we pick WestJet on a regular basis. So for them to say there's literally nothing we can do, I know that's a load of shit.
Yeah, I think one of the things that came to mind right away is that we've always heard these stories of them overbooking flights because that's the way that they know they're going to maximize profits. And if they get any little excuse to say no to anybody, they probably do so that, you know,
right.
So that they're not overbooked anymore.
And then on top of it, we had friends that were on that same Swoop flight, and they had the audacity, knowing full well what happened to the four of us, like four out of the six of us that were on that swoop flight, they had the audacity to page us numerous times for a final boarding call.
So you can hear your name being called, but you know darn well there's no way they're letting us on there.
We were long gone, but we had the groom's mother was on, mother and father were on that plane, and they heard it. And apparently she tore a strip off of them that was pretty ignorant and low of them to do that.
Yeah, because the people who are traveling back that weren't with you guys at the robbery location are probably just worried sick about how you guys are going to make up.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well,
it's been quite an experience, that's for sure.
Is there any questions that I didn't ask or something that you thought you wanted to tell me about this story that I didn't get?
No, I think that we covered most of it. My big thing right now, it's not necessarily about the money and the recovery. Like, we can, and we have started a claim already with our home insurance, even though we're going to get it twice now that our home insurance is going to go up because we've made a claim.
Yeah.
We'll see if we recover money from anybody else. It's not about that. My main goal right now, I don't even care about the airline. If you want to go by rules, whatever.
Yeah.
Like, yes, we're out thousands of dollars. We're probably, between my husband and I, we're probably out $15,000 in total, if not more. My main goal right now is to make sure that no one stays Airbnb ever again. It's literally the most dangerous thing that you can do. Like, you might as well, it's probably safer to stay at a hostel. At least you know what you're getting into.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think this is, it sounds very similar to a lot of the stuff we've been hearing about Uber in the past couple of years, where it's like, they don't necessarily vet the drivers the same way that a taxi cab company has to. They don't necessarily have all of the best, you know, precautions and safety for the riders and that sort of thing. And it sounds
right.
Like this is a similar kind of experience, but basically through, instead of a car, it's a place where you sleep, you know? It's they use
right.
an app. You log in through the app, get your stay, you go, and then something terrible happens, and there's not really a lot of recourse for the victims here.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and, like, it's just, it's going to be a longing process because now we've had to cancel all of our cards. They have government-issued ID from us. They have three pieces of government-issued ID because my AHS swipe card was there, my Alberta Health, and my passport. So now I need to make a claim with Equifax. So now every time I go to apply for credit, I'm going to have to go through a huge process because I need that information on file in case they try and steal our identity.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that seems like the most likely thing. If you get all that kind of documentation from somebody, that's the most valuable thing to use it for.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I thank you so much for sharing your story, and I hope that anybody out there that's, you know, watches or listens to this story that's thinking about doing Airbnb whatever possible research they can possibly do to try and protect themselves, but it really seems like you did that and still ended up in a situation where there was pretty significant risk and then, you know, had this terrible thing happen, so...
Absolutely.
Do you expect anything from Airbnb? Like, do you think that they'll have any kind of policy change, or like, is there something you want specifically from them, or just for people to avoid it?
I'd like to see them do security and background checks, at least from their hosts. Like, that's something that I would like to see. Personally, at this point, I'm already beyond angry about this whole thing, and I'd like to shut it down, but I know that's not realistic.
Yeah.
But I would like to see some sort of a security background check on these people and do more than just verify with picture ID, because clearly, now they have my picture ID, who's to say that they're not going to use mine to go and start another house at Airbnb?
You could be the next 27-year-old mother of two who runs a place. Yeah, interesting.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
So,
anything else you think I should ask you about?
People have six properties in Las Vegas. I have reported each one of those on Airbnb, but just be mindful of who you're renting from, that's for sure.
Yeah, right on. Well, thank you for the story, and thanks for, you know, warning people who might not know about how Airbnb works, that there's
great
possible bad experiences, and that they could be avoided.
Yeah. Well, one thing I do have to say is that once we made it to Canadian soil, the hospitality changed huge. There was, so Nissan Canada covered our key fobs to be replaced. They also covered our towing of our vehicle, and they paid up to $100 per night for our hotel. Four Point Sheraton and Nisku discounted our rooms and went above and beyond. They held a room without charging us until we got there, until we checked out, and they only charged us, even though technically we got there in the morning, they only charged us one day so that there wasn't extra stuff added on to our already costly adventure. And then Park and Fly in Edmonton at the Edmonton International Airport, they also allowed us to stay in staff quarters until our vehicle got towed, and they, because we had no winter gear, and they also gave us a ride over to our hotel afterwards.
Wow.
So there is good Canadian hospitality out there still, no matter what.
That's a good story, I guess, the way, yeah, you know, the way that Canadians react when you get back home and take care,
yeah,
of our own, so that's good.
Right, yeah, on. Exactly.
Well, if you do find out anything more, if Airbnb contacts you back, if there's any kind of updates, feel free to give me a ring and, you know, or
for sure,
send me a message, whatever it is, let me know.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks so much for covering this.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call today.
You're welcome.
Have
Talk
a good
to you
one.
Later.
Bye-bye.
You too. Bye.
Wow. So, a warning to Canadians traveling down to the States who may be staying at Airbnb from a local right here in Medicine Hat. Her name's Lorianne. Thanks so much for watching Community TV. If you've got any tips, news stories, something that you'd like to share with me, you could send me an email, tom@comtv.ca, or of course contact me on any of the social medias where you may have consumed this story, whether it be YouTube comments section, a direct message, Facebook, Twitter, maybe the Instagram. Once again, thanks so much for watching. Have a great day.